Good evening. Welcome to Horticulturally Yours. Hopefully the summer's about over, at least the heat part of it. But I understand we're supposed to have a real brutal week this week, but it will soon be over. I'd like to welcome you to Horticulturally Yours. My name is Dr. Barry Palmer. I am the producer and host, and I have two of my acquaintees with me this evening. Grace Klein. Grace has been on the show three or four times before. She is the past president and one of the founders of the Laureldale Garden Club and also a charter member of the Herb Society of America. Grace, nice to have you here.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
And our other presenter over here is Mr. Dieter. What did you think I was going to call him?
I have no idea.
Mr. Dieter Walter. Dieter's been on this show probably 10, 15 times.
Almost, yeah. Sure.
Dieter's the owner of Temple Greenhouse, and he's also the founder of Willie's German Goodies.
See that.
Which we'll hear more about tonight.
All right.
And a lot of topics for tonight. Fall bloomers, herbs, dried flowers, the Laureldale Flower Show, which really looks very interesting. Figs, pruning, vinegars, poinsettias, and bringing plants indoors. That's quite an agenda. And now I'm going to turn it over to our horticultural specialist here, Grace Klein.
Thank you, Barry. Well, we're going to talk about a variety of things today. We're going to touch on herbs, and we planted them last spring, and now what do you do with them? So we're going to talk a little bit about that. And the first thing I'd like to tell you is that I brought my marjoram along. I've wintered this over, and it's okay. I wintered this over, and it's very, very good. Now, Dieter said he likes to put it on pork roast.
Pork, absolutely.
Yeah. Yes. Now, what I would do when I bring it in, I will trim this back. And you can dry this also. You just strip the stems down. But I'll bring this in. My favorite thing to do with marjoram, sweet marjoram, is stews. But the favorite thing is to put it on a bagel in the morning and drench it with butter and then sprinkle this. And it's delicious. A very, very good morning treat for you. Also, it's very good in any like pot pie, any kind of a pasta. And you can winter it over. It is not hardy, so you have to bring it in. Otherwise, you have to start fresh, you know, each year. Another one of my favorites right now, and this is fall blooming. This is a garlic chive. This is a regular chive, which blooms abundantly in the spring. Now, there's one here and one there right now, but not like in the springtime, in the summer. But right now, these are absolutely gorgeous, and you can dry them. And the best thing to do if you want to save and use the chive, the garlic chive, you can take these and you can chop them up and put them in salads, maybe omelets, soups, and they are very, very easy to raise, but you have to be very careful with the garlic chives because what happens is when these flowers go, there's the seed pods and they go everywhere. So be very, very careful where you put them, and you can save the seed if you want to and pass them along, but they're very, very easy to raise. And they also look pretty in an arrangement.
They
so.
Look fun in almost yeah. any garden.
They sort of take on like an oriental look, I yeah. think.
The difference between the regular chives, for people that don't realize it, the regular chives have the roundish or hollow leaves, where the garlic chives have the flat leaf. And the regular chives have the purple flower, and the garlic chives have the white flowers. And like Grace said, it's much later in the year that the garlic chives really come into flower, and they taste both the same, mm-hmm. really good.
You know, something that's amazing, you would think that they would smell bad, but the flowers actually have a sweet fragrance to them, right. Slight sweet fragrance to them, instead of a garlic flavor.
These are going to seed right now.
Yes, they are. They're all over my side yard, and you have to really pick them off if you don't want them to blow further in the wind.
They'll be growing up in the cracks and the vacuum.
Yeah, that's true. We can come back and harvest them next year. I also brought along rosemary, and I know that Dieter brought one along too. Mine's in bloom right now. I don't know whether you can see them or not, and yours isn't.
Mine isn't.
No, but yours is a different kind.
Yeah.
Mine is a creeping, and I like it because it hangs over, and this is something else that you've got to bring in. Yours is an upright, but tell them why that is really a good kind to have, because you can skewer them around, like if you're going to be doing something.
You can make
a
wreath out of this. This is a barbecue rosemary, really good for the bar. Oh, can you see it somewhere? Okay, sorry. The barbecue has a little different taste, and I think it's quite nice. The prostrate really lends itself really nice for the hanging baskets. Mm-hmm. And the trick with rosemary, people always say, why do my rosemaries die? In Italy, they never do. Well, this isn't Italy.
No.
They're very touchy in the house. If you get them too wet, they die. If you get them too dry, they die. Mm-hmm. It's you have to hit that happy medium, and I think they're one of the touchiest ones. I think one of the other shows I mentioned that when we used to have hanging baskets of them, I had a big sign on them, Norbert, don't water. Norbert used to be my father-in-law, and every time he watered them, they died. So don't water them.
No, you have to be very, very careful, because one day they're beautiful, and if they dry overnight, the next day they're long gone. So you just have to strike a happy medium. And a lot of times people think, oh, I'll bring them in and put them in a hot, sunny window, and that doesn't work either, because it dries it out. Yeah. So keep it on the cool side, and just make sure it's watered and not over-watered. I'd like to talk about some of the other things you can do with your herbs. And this is vinegar, which this is the end of my vinegars for this year. I brought two of mine along. This is a tarragon vinegar, and you say, how do you make them? Well, very easily. You buy store-bought vinegar, and you add, this is French tarragon, and make sure you get the French tarragon, because the others won't have the flavor. The tarragon has like a slight anise flavor to it. So it's very nice, and the bottles, if you have any friends that drink or whatever, you can tell them to save the bottles for you, and you can make them very nice as Christmas presents for people. And this is, I end up maybe making two basic kinds. You can make all kinds. But this is one of my favorites, and this is an Italian red wine vinegar. And what I have in here is the sweet basil, and I also have some garlic cloves in here. And this lasts, like I say, this lasts a long time. And this is also, you can use a red wine vinegar, and you can add some of your own wine if you like. But it's very, very good, and again, that'll last you for a year. It won't. Another thing, too, I should mention, if you're going to be giving it away, sometimes the herbs, they get sort of rancid looking. So what I would do if I'm going to be making my vinegars now, I would take them and put the herbs in there. But then before I'd want to gift it to someone, I would take the herbs and take those out and add fresh ones to it. I must say, one of my chores in the garden, I love to be in the garden. It's just delightful to me to, and right now my garden is a jungle, so every time I clear out a space, I feel like I've really accomplished something. But these little tomatoes, I didn't raise any of the big ones this year, but these little, they're called sun sugars or
sun sugar.
Sun sugars. This is my candy. While I'm working in the garden, these are the sweetest, sweetest tomatoes you'll ever want to taste. And I often thought, oh, I don't think I'll like orange tomatoes. But these are absolutely delicious. So next year, put this on your list. And while you're working in the garden, they never make it to my kitchen. I'm usually eating them as I'm going along working.
We have a big pot outside the greenhouse, just right next to the street.
Uh-huh.
And we have one of those sun sugars in there, and also Hungarian wax pepper and stuff. It's amazing. As soon as the tomatoes turn orange, for some dumb reason, they're not there anymore. We have a lot of people that walk 8th Avenue, and all of a sudden, the tomatoes are gone. It's amazing. They're really so sweet.
Yes, they are. And like I said, I never thought I would like an orange tomato, but they're a must. I have four of them. I had gotten them from you. Just little bitty plants, and they are just going to town right now.
May I have one, Grace?
You certainly may. There you go.
You sold me.
Okay, now these may not be extra ripe, but they're pretty ripe. Mm. But I wait till they're really, really red-orange, and yeah. Then I enjoy them. Some of the other things that we have here. Well, here are some of the chives. We both mentioned chives. But now these chives are dried. So it doesn't mean that necessarily you have to eat your chives. I like to decorate with them, and I love to make floral arrangements. So these I dried in the springtime. And these will stay for a year or two if you let them, you know. And they don't drop. And you can use them in floral designs. Mm-hmm. And let me see here. Some of the other uses we have. We're just touching on different things. Peter said, bring some potpourri, what you do with your herbs and so forth. So I did. I brought potpourri, which has a really, really nice. This is bits and pieces of your flowers from the garden that you've dried, and you can add fragrance to it, oils, and it lasts a long time. I've made little pillows out of them, and here's another one. And you can put them as sachets in your drawers, or you can put them under your pillows, and then when you go to sleep at night, just turn your pillow over and you have a nice fragrance. I've made a lot of different kinds, and the one is what I call a bug bag. I didn't bring that along, but it's nice to keep in with your blankets and things, and it deters pests, all kinds of...
Well, as long as you put some bay leaves in with it.
Oh, you can put bay leaves in.
Yeah, because they really deter the bugs.
Oh, yeah. There's all kinds that I've made. I've made a citrus. It's fun. It really is a fun thing to do if you really get into making different potpourris. Put this over here by you.
A lot of people ask us always, what do you do when you have an overabundance of the herbs, and how do you keep them so that you have some in the wintertime? And it is always, there's so many different ways. You can dry some. You put them in the microwave a very short time on or low, or in the regular oven, and put them on a cookie sheet, and just dry them very slowly. You don't want to do it quick, otherwise you burn the heck out of them. But the way I like to do it is I like to have the fresh taste of the herbs all winter long. And so this is the time of year where my wife makes a lot of herb butter. And actually, I brought some along for you to taste, Gracie.
Okay.
And
I'll pass it over to you.
You pass it over. And what it amounts to is we melt the butter a little bit, not totally, but just soften it, And then we add the herbs into it. It's a mixture of herbs. There's some basil in it, a lot of parsley, some chives, some sage, some rosemary. Very little rosemary because that's a little too strong. But then what we do is we put it on a piece of bread, and it is really good. If you can picture it with like hard-boiled eggs, you slice them and put a little bit of slice of hard-boiled eggs on top of this, or just a little tiny bit of tomato on it.
Cucumbers.
It's really good. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is my favorite way of taking the herbs in for the winter. Other people put herbs in ice trays. Ice cube trays. They put the herbs in, put some water over it. Basil doesn't hold the color well when you're drying it, and it doesn't hold the flavor. But when you put it in water and then you freeze the whole thing in water, then it keeps the flavor. And then all you have to do is take the ice cubes out and plop it into whatever you want to use it. And I think that works really well. The other thing is you chop up the basils, and again with the butter works fantastic. Any other ways that there's so many ways that you can use the herbs, and you should use them because it adds so much flavor. The other day my wife and I had a dill sauce, beautiful dill sauce. You bet you would never guess what we had with the dill sauce.
I have no idea.
Oh, with me, you would never know.
No,
anyway.
No.
Raccoon.
No. I went down to the shore and I got an eel. So we cooked eel into the dill sauce. Oh, was that delicious?
Oh,
that's a German delicacy.
Absolutely. Yes, indeed. And unfortunately, the guy there only had one eel, so we couldn't take too many. But he says, come back in September and I'll have a bunch, and then I'll smoke some. You got to try it. It's really good.
You mentioned the ice cubes. I've done that with the basil, but you can also do that with tea.
Yes.
If you don't want to dry your tea, and you can always have that ready. And your butter also. I've made different herb butters, and then I put them in little containers, and they'll keep for the year. So that's something to think about, putting things away in your freezer, that you have this taste of herbs. Year-round. Do you have any more herbs that you want to share, any information?
It's just the basil. This is just a basil plant. And I found out that we have, I think there's over 100 different varieties of basil. This is just a regular sweet basil. I really like the ones that is the tiny leaves. They are so much more a little stronger, and I think they have a better taste.
That's a bush basil.
A little bush basil.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Then this year I found another one. Except the name escapes me. You can actually chop up the whole stem and everything.
Oh, really?
It is a soft stem. It is really different. So next year I'll have to have some of that.
Yeah, I'll have to know about
that. Yeah, that one is. It is. It's not a big plant, but it gets really nice and bushy. But you can use the whole stem. It's a softer stem. Mm-hmm. So we'll have some of that for next year.
I like the red basil too because of the color.
It
makes a nice picture if you're going to be serving it on a salad platter or so forth.
Yep.
I did bring along the Egyptian top onions, which are really great. This is really an old. Onion, it goes back to Egyptian days. But these get really huge, and you can use these, chop these up, put them in your vinegars. You can tie them up and string them up like they do other onions and garlics. But they're very flavorful, and I don't use this anymore because this is, of course, long gone. But this part, if you save these, they're very, very tender. And you can add that to salads, soups, stews, anything that you could think of.
Now, will most of these herbs self-seed?
No.
No?
Most of the herbs are not hardy in this area. There's, like in the lavender, for instance, we handle about 8 or 9 different varieties of lavenders, mm-hmm. but the only one that's semi-hardy in this area is the Munstead variety. We have a French lavender, we have the Edelweiss lavender, which gets a white flower instead of a purple. Mm-hmm. We have, you know, a number of different ones, and it's a real lacy one. And so, but the Munstead is the one that mm-hmm. when you feel that you should have in a planter outside, that's the one you want. Mm-hmm. But yes. At best, 50-50. If you have a nice warm winter, they'll survive. Otherwise, most likely they won't.
Well, now my favorite one is the Hidcote, and I find that that's very, very hardy.
Yeah.
And that is the deepest of color.
Right.
The deepest purple, and it's a little taller than the Munstead. But there's so many varieties. You just have to see what works for you in your garden. Yeah. And
well, it's the same thing. Like people come to us and with the figs, mm-hmm. and they say, "Well, which variety is the hardy ones?" And we have in Temple, we have a lot of Italian clients there, and they all have their fig trees, and they go to great length as to how to overwinter them. I know on Kutztown Road, the one lady, she actually builds houses for the fig trees. It looks like little castles. Actually, over wintertime, it looks like nutcrackers almost. She has a house that looks like a nutcracker, and just for the fig trees. Now, my neighbor, she doesn't do a darn thing with them. She has them planted outside in the yard, next to the house, and or next to the creek and next to the wherever. And they just come up. They're huge bushes, and they are absolutely delicious. So if you haven't tried a fresh fig, this is the time. You got to try them. They are so delicious this year, and with as much heat as they had this year, I think there are about 3 or 4 weeks earlier than other years, and much, much sweeter. So,
do they need much moisture, Dieter?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, they do.
That
makes on the size. If the more moisture they have, then the bigger the size is. Like this year, they didn't have much moisture, so the figs are a little smaller, but again, very much sweeter. Mm-hmm. And in case you don't see them, this is a tiny fig. This one is almost shriveled up, but it is so sweet. It is it's unreal. Now this one here is a fresher one. As you can see, this one is just picked today. Both of them are, but this one is looks almost like it's going to heck already.
Looks like a cocoon.
Yeah, but and they. Tie them up and make wreaths out of them to dry them and stuff, but they never make it that far either.
Well, you know what? I remember my grandmother always having a fig tree, and she always wrapped hers with old blankets and
right.
with rope, and she'd tie it up. I never remember her ever feeding it, though. I mean, now you say you should feed them. What do we feed them?
Well, just regular plant food. In the early spring, I think it will help a lot. Now, we have people that will dig them out every year, lay them on its side mm-hmm. and bury them. Or we will have, like I said, they go at great length. They put burlap around
yeah.
them. They do all kinds of things. So it can be all done. I have a white fig in the greenhouse, and that one I think is a lot more touchy mm-hmm. than the purple fig. But
Well, I'm going to bring mine in. I have it still in its pot. This is its
right.
first year. I'm going to bring it in, put it in my garden room, and then next spring I'll get brave, and hopefully I will put it in the garden and
but
see what happens.
It's time for our break.
It is?
A BCTV break.
My goodness, we never had a break before.
No.
You're watching Horticulturally Yours on BCTV.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information about gardening, go to bctv.org.
Yeah, well, we caught you all eating.
Well, sorry about that. This time, I think we brought more stuff in to eat than we ever did before. We brought some figs along, brought some herb butter, some bread along.
Tomatoes.
Tomatoes. So we're enjoying this show very much.
Well, I think I'd like to talk a little bit about a garden presentation, a flower show done in miniature. It's going to be September the 11th, Saturday, and it's going to be held at the Muhlenberg Community Library from 1 to 5.
That's on Kutztown Road.
Kutztown Road. We have a beautiful library. It's really, really nice. And Laureldale Garden Club is presenting it. And when I say miniature, I really do mean a miniature. All the arrangements will be done very from maybe 8 inches down to about maybe 2 inches, 3 inches. And we have various categories. We have class one is a home sweet home. And this is going to be a composition, a courtyard. Now, class two is called Peter Pumpkin Eater. And that is not to exceed anywhere higher than 5 feet high by 5 feet wide. Class three, it's a small.
Feet, did you say inches or feet?
Inches.
Inches.
You said feet.
Did I?
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
I was going to say that's a big miniature.
It must be your butter that's getting to me.
Okay.
It's a small world. Is our class three, and this is going to be a line design. There's differences between line designs and mass designs. And it's going to have an international flavor, and they've got to, the gals that are going to be presenting this must name the country that they're representing. Class four is, it's called For Dolly Dearest, and that is going to be a tussin-mussy, not to exceed 2 inches. And class five is My Favorite Fairy Tale, and that is not to exceed 4 inches by 4 inches. Little House on the Prairie is a wildflower mass arrangement. Class 7 is By the Sea. And class 8 is a Doll's Tea Party, which I had these little miniature box rooms made. So each class that I've mentioned is going to be, there'll be four entries in each, and it will be a judged show. So I think children would enjoy this as well as the grown-ups. So I hope to see a lot of you there, and if you have any questions, call the library and they can help you out. And enjoy an afternoon. It's free to get in, and just enjoy the day. Bring your little ones, and it's a nice day out. There's not many places you can go to get free entertainment, so I encourage you all to bring your grandchildren, your nieces, your children, and come and enjoy the miniature flower show that we're going to be presenting.
Oh, this is so civilized.
Yeah.
It's really nice, Greg.
I brought along a few miniatures that I've done. This one, if you can see it, is a miniature sort of done in an oriental style. I don't know if you can see it. But anyhow, this bottom was a piece of office furniture that just fell out of somewhere, office furniture, and but I used it. I thought it sort of had an oriental flavor to it. So these are not going to be in the flower show. These are just examples. This is just an idea. This is what we consider a mass arrangement. It's all for fall in fall colors. And I'm going to lay that down. And this is a little arrangement, and some you're allowed to use accessories. So here we have a little oriental man, a side of a flower arrangement. And the vase, you said, where can you get vases? That's actually a bead that I put the arrangement in. And this is... Now that maybe looks ugly, but it's really neat for Halloween. But this is actually my Pyrus japonica. what's left now. It should be cut off. When I'm doing pruning and cutting, I always think, oh, that would really be neat. So then I try. But this could be very, very effective. And, you know, if you have a desk space or a powder room or your children, give them stuff to play with. And here we have what's going to go with it, a little miniature, Happy Halloween, and some Sweet Annie with it, which is an herb. And by the way, you cannot use in a florist show, you cannot use any artificial silks or anything like that. Everything has to be according to schedule, either fresh and or dry, depending on what it calls for. Let me see. Some other dried things I brought along. Of course, the hydrangeas, which are always beautiful. And these are great for contrived flowers. These are hosta, the blooms from hosta, which you can make some very, very pretty if you gather them and do certain things. They're what we call a contrived flower, and I didn't really make anything up. Dried flowers. This is Lunaria. A lot of people, it's called Honesty. There's many names for it. Silver dollar plant is what most of the people know it as. And somebody said to me last year, theirs does not get nice. But the reason being of that was that they forgot to peel it. There's like a coating, and you've got to peel those down, and there's lots of seeds that fall away from there. Okay, and if you're out walking, there's a lot of things that you can use. This is what is called mullein. This is all freebies. And the yarrow, that's really nice. That's dried. This is from last year. So you can see it really lasts a long time. Now, this one was mullein. This is called moth mullein. So if you're out walking or running, look at the nature as you're walking and going and looking at these things. These things are just so beautiful. If you combine some of those together with the yarrow and the moth mullein or the regular mullein, and also these are a bonus here.
Iris.
Yes, these are Siberian iris. Let me put these down. And, they have lots of seeds. But this is what's left after your Siberian iris blooms. They're great in fall arrangements. So you might want to go out in your garden, and if you haven't cut them down already, cut a bouquet and bring them in and arrange them with some of the other dried things. It's really fun to go out and really look and see what you have, which is usable. This is a little arrangement I just did quick this afternoon with some of the dried flowers, and it's in a colonial brick. And when I say a colonial brick, we have all kinds of colonial containers. This is what they look like. They have like little holes, so if you're not an expert flower arranger, you just stuff them in those holes, and it'll turn out very, very nice.
That is beautiful.
Thank you. Well, now that's the white is something called, you want to hold that. Mm-hmm. This is called, this is all dried, Deutzia gracilis, if you're familiar with that. Okay. It blooms in the spring. This is pieces of hydrangea, and of course roses, and that's the purple status. So if you ever get a bouquet at home, and you have some of the status, even some of the roses, maybe some rosebuds don't open. So dry them and play around with them, and it's a lot of fun to really see what you really can use. Let's put this here. Let me see. Oh, and I was cleaning out one end of the yard the other day, and this I was hacking this down. I call it inkberry. I don't know the correct name. I call it inkberry. It's very, very messy, but I thought, gee, that would look pretty in my colonial five-finger vase. And I brought it in, and I put the berries down. You probably saw this if you're walking along the woodlands and so forth. I put those in, and then I added the black-eyed Susans. And I put a few of the marigolds in, and it made a nice arrangement. It really doesn't cost much to make an arrangement, and just look around your garden.
The birds love the inkberries.
Yes, right? Yes, but they're all over my...
Especially if you have a white car.
Oh, no.
It really looks pretty.
Oh, no.
Yes. And trying to get rid of them once you have them.
Yeah.
Be a real...
This is another flower, and then I'm going to let you talk about pruning, because that's very important for fall. This is called tansy. And it's a little button flower, and this will also dry, so you could add those. And I've been saving drying things because I knew this show was coming up in fall, and so I've been drying on my kitchen counter. Every time I see something that I think might dry, I try it. And I do dry weeds and everything, and some of the weeds really do dry beautifully. So enjoy your garden, and come see our show. So Dieter.
Yes.
Okay.
Saturday, September 11th.
11th, yes. Mm-hmm. From 1 to 5.
We have, in the fall, it's a really interesting time because people are going to be taking plants that they have outside and are planning on bringing them inside. So what I would always suggest before you bring them inside, do treat them with a bug insecticide, because it's a lot easier to treat it outside than it is inside. At this time of the year, if you get a systemic insecticide and sprinkle it around the plant will absorb it and will kill the bugs that way. Most of the bugs that we have here in the houses are like the aphids, the red spiders, they're all sucking insects. So what they do is they suck the juice out of the plants. So by poisoning the juice is actually what you're doing, even though it doesn't harm you, but it kills the bugs. So the systemic is one of the best things that you want to use. It doesn't hurt you. The plant absorbs it quite nicely, and it does... has a lasting effect of most of the time 4 to 6 weeks. Mm. So if you put it in right now, it will be safe then to bring the plants in the middle of September, and you won't have the bug problem. I think a lot of people have that when they come into the houses, that, oh, what do I do with the bugs? And the other thing is people that have the ficus tree. They put them outside for the winter, for the summer, and then bring them inside. Then they call me, and why the heck is that ficus tree losing all its leaf? Mm-hmm. Well, it does that every time you change conditions. So if you have them outside in the sun, and which they absolutely love, and then you bring it inside, yes, it will drop most likely over 50% of the leaves. It is a natural thing. And then the leaves will appear again. But so don't call me right away. We have the herbs, not the herbs, but the perennials. A lot of times people call and say, well, this one here is a daisy. And the people call and say, well, how far should I cut it back? Well, we trimmed this year last week just to show you how far you should do it. I would always suggest leaving 5 or 6 inches on the plant and let it die down gradually. And then most of the perennials will bloom or will sprout out from the base of the plants. Same thing as with roses. There's two schools of thought. Either you trim them in the fall lightly and then in the spring heavy, or you don't trim them at all in the fall and then just start trimming them in the springtime. So there's always a bunch of different, however you feel comfortable in doing it. The roses, when I trim them, the rose bushes, it's a very interesting rule of thumb. Whatever is thick, you trim very lightly, and whatever is thin, you trim hard. So because the thick sprouts, the thick branches will be able to carry much more weight next year, and it will be a lot nicer and sprouting out next year, where the thin ones will not really be able to give you lots of flowers. So I think that is the easiest way of saying it. Now this one here is the hardy hibiscus. The hardy hibiscus is a very interesting plant. Most of the time it will get flowers up to almost dinner plate size. Now this one here is a young plant, and we started out as a very small slip this in the springtime. Now next year, when we trim it back now, we will trim it back to about 5-6 inches. And the darn thing will die back totally. I mean, the whole stem will turn brown, and most of the husbands are very nice then. They go along in the yard and pull them out because they're dead branches. Well, what happens is the right out of the inside the ground, they will sprout out then, and it will be come new plant next year, and it will be much bushier then. Yes, we have a home viewer.
Go ahead, home viewer.
Oh.
Hello.
Yes, hi, my name is Andrea. I was wondering if you could give me some tips on trimming a hydrangea.
The hydrangea is always interesting. First of all, if you trim it too hard, then you're cutting the next year's flowers off. So I would always say trim it not too darn hard, and I always wait till they sprout out next year first before I start trimming it. It's much easier that way, and you can actually see, prune the dead stuff out next spring, and that way you won't cut the flowers off. Lilac bushes, people call a lot of times and say, well, why isn't my lilac bushes blooming? Well, when did you cut it back? Well, I just cut it back, meaning in July and August. Well, what you did is you cut next year's flowers off already. Mm-hmm. Azaleas, if you cut them back right after the flower is gone, then it's no problem. They bush out, and they will set new buds. If you cut them back now, you're cutting the flowers off for next year. The same thing is with the hydrangea. So if you cut them back at all, hydrangeas are tricky because they bloom so late and the flowers stay so late. So a lot of times I don't like to trim them at all till they start sprouting in the spring, and then I just prune all the dead stuff out. I hope that answered
okay,
your question.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I recognize.
Helps a lot. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
I recognize that voice. Yeah.
Okay.
Is she a club member?
No. It's family.
Oh.
It's family.
My little cousin.
Well, that's good.
Yeah. But you know what? Now, if she would want to, cut the hydrangeas off to dry.
Absolutely.
That's fine. Right
that's
now,
fine.
You can
yeah.
do that. Yeah.
Yeah. That won't hurt it because the side shoots will bloom next year.
I had a question from somebody, not a home viewer, but somebody, one of my neighbors, wants to know about the crepe myrtle. And I said, it's almost like the lilac.
Almost, yeah.
Yeah.
It's if you cut them too late, then always when a bush, that's a flowering bush, I think the best rule of thumb is right after they flowered, the flowers spent, then you trim them.
Mm-hmm.
If you trim them too late, you cut in the next year's flowers off. And, you know, most of the time that's the way it works. The other thing this time of year, people like yourself have gorgeous poinsettias in the yard. And they say, well, what the heck, how do I get them to flower? This is actually the time. This is the first show that we actually can say it's still coming up. The timing is just perfect. This is a poinsettia in the greenhouse right now. This is the size. And what I did today is I took, I gave it a soft pinch. So all I did is took the little tips out like this. Okay? Now, what it does, it will branch out. It still has enough time right now.
Okay. The reason I'm interested is this is the first year, like I told you, that I wintered a poinsettia over. And I just had it in my garden room. And it just started growing. I just watered it. And it's beautiful. Now, should I pinch those tops off?
Most likely not.
Okay.
Now, like for us, now this plant will be about this big by the time we get it done. This will have 6 or 8 flowers on, but that's because we took a soft pinch. Now, if it is not a really huge plant, you can do that, and it will branch out. Okay, it's still time for that.
Yeah.
Now, I always feel that right around August the 15th to the 20th, you can go as late as August, September the 15th to pinch them.
Okay.
But then it's pretty tricky. For the poinsettia to make Christmas in bloom for on September the 15th on for 40 days in a row, it has to have 12 hours of darkness and 12 hours of light. Okay, so you can't just put it in a closet and forget it. It doesn't work that way. And if you really want to be a nice host to your poinsettia, then you carry it every day and every morning in the sunshine, and in the afternoon you bring it back into the dark. But what the difference is, the September 15th on, it is automatically 12 hours of darkness and 12 hours of light. It's the summer solstice. It's September the 15th. The winter, you know, whatever. But then it's the equal time, dark and night. So that has to be 40 days in a row to initiate the flower.
September 21st.
September 15th on, yeah.
Oh.
Should
yeah.
I be feeding it anything now?
Oh, yeah. If you feed it right now, that will increase the size of the flower or the bracts.
Okay, and anything special?
I would say most likely for the home viewer, I would say the general purpose or the blossom booster, I think, will do fine.
Mm-hmm. What's it called?
Blossom booster.
Okay.
It's the second number is higher than the first and the last. And
we have another home viewer.
Oh, terrific.
Go ahead, home viewer. Hello?
Yes. I have a temporary rose bush, and I was wondering, when do I trim that back? In now or in the spring?
Topiary rose bushes, where you have the stem and then you have the branches that come up.
Mm-hmm.
All the topiary rose bushes are grafted on a wild rose bush stem. And what will freeze out is that part that where it branches out. So I would always trim it back a little bit, because what happens is otherwise you can't protect it.
Well, now this I have in a pot, so I can bring this in.
Oh, that's good. Then enjoy the flowers as long as they last. And then once the flowers are spent in the fall, because most of the rose bushes will bloom again in the fall, so after the flowers are spent, then trim it back and bring it inside and put it in where it's a lot of light.
And should I feed it?
Not too much in the wintertime.
Okay.
But in the spring, yes. But,
okay.
Not so much in the wintertime.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
Okay.
Will they keep their leaves all winter then?
Yeah, as long as it's inside, yeah. Mm-hmm. Actually, some of the roses, when you tie them up outside and you don't cut them back in the fall, then a lot of them, the leaves will turn brown, but they will still be on there as such, but that will protect it a little bit more also. But the rose trees are always tricky. There, if you can't bring them inside, you're fighting a losing battle. They are, again, like the figs, you have to lay them down and all that stuff. So this is a time where you can start thinking about perpetuating your plans, meaning that in about another month or so, the plants that are outside, the ones that are soft, then you can take cuttings off. You can do that and then start bringing them in and growing them for next year. We have people that like to try and keep their geraniums from one year to the next. And I have heard some interesting stories, shall we say it that way. They have some that they actually pull the whole plant, hang them upside down, and then try to bring them back to life again. But the best thing is throw the old ones away, buy new ones, keep me in business, and they're much more vigorous next year if you get start with young, more vigorous plants.
Well, I have one that's huge, tall. Oh, another home viewer?
Another home viewer. Go ahead, home viewer. Hello?
Hello. I have a question for Dieter.
Yes.
Is that a clean shirt? Because there's not dirt on it yet. Is it new?
Well, you know, I was at a greenhouse's pinching poinsettias today, so what happened? Yeah, it's a new shirt, yeah. You must know me pretty well.
I think I know you very well.
And another home viewer.
Yes?
Hello?
Hello. I have three knockout roses, and I'd like to know, should they bloom all summer long?
Mm-hmm. Well, the knockout roses will mostly bloom a lot more than any other rose. Shall we say it that way? Not all summer long, no. The roses, the knockouts will almost bloom, you can say almost continuously, but they do have certain stages. In other words, in the spring it will bloom abundantly, really a lot of flowers. And then it'll go partially dormant, but you will have a flower here, a flower there. So it's not the same amount. Now in the fall, most of the time the roses, like the hybrid teas and the others, they all have another shoot, another flush of flowers that is coming due now. And I think the knockouts will get more vigorous again. If you go cut a rose and like for Valentine's Day, the growers have to cut the rose in the beginning of September in order to time them for Valentine's Day. Otherwise, you mess up the whole timing. So it takes a certain amount of time to get them to rebloom.
And when should they be trimmed or cut back?
I would say in the spring.
In the spring?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Great.
Gracie, I think you're going to finish this off.
I have an announcement. Yes, I do. The Heritage Festival, which is going to take place October the 2nd and 3rd, it's the 29th annual Heritage Festival. And they have a lot of entertainment and all kinds of programming. They have plowing, they have horses and wagons and all kinds of things, and entertainment. Cakewalks, children's games, activities, storytellers, an Appalachian pet farm, and all kinds of tours.
Petting farm.
Yeah, petting farm this year.
Is this out at the Red Bridge?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I won't be there, sorry to say. I'm going to be attending a wedding. But usually I'm there doing an herb program. But attend this. This is really something really nice, and it's good for all ages. Like I said, they have lots of children's activities and lots to do and see. So,
and that's October?
October the 2nd and 3rd. Mm-hmm. 11 to 5.
That's put on by our Parks Department.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Berks County. Okay. Heritage Festival, Parks and Recreation, department, right near the airport out there. It's very easy to find. So I hope you'll visit them and enjoy the day. And don't forget now to attend our September the 11th miniature show at the Community Library in Laureldale. So thank you.
That miniature show is going to be something you don't get to see very often.
No, it's going to be.
That looks very special.
I'm enjoying getting ready for it. Yeah. So, and anything, Dieter, that you want to add?
It's always a pleasure to being here.
Oh, and, yes.
Thank you both very much.
Oh,
Grace,
you're quite welcome.
Dieter, you both did so much work for this show. And I'd like to thank you both. And Grace is also going in the stages of planning a holiday show for us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with decorations and festive foods and all
different kinds of foods.
That's not my alley.
I'm thinking more along the lines of artistic design.
Sometime
and
around November, early December, we'll do something.
Yeah, right after Thanksgiving.
Folks, good night.